ओके, तो टुडेज एजेंडा ऑफ दिस सेशन इज दैट वी विल सी वन न्यू टॉपिक दैट इज कैरेक्टरिस्टिक ऑफ डिजिटल आईसीज एंड सेकेंड वन इज सिंस सम ऑफ यू आर ऑलरेडी आस्किंग फॉर सम प्रॉब्लम सॉल्यूशंस विच वी आई मीन ऑन द टॉपिक्स विच वी ऑलरेडी कवर्ड इन प्रीवियस लेक्चर्स. So we'll means after completion of that new topic, we'll cover that also. So if you are having any doubts, we will cover up. So we'll move faster in that sense to complete all the topics. So let me share my presentation first. Is this slide visible to all of you? Anyone please reply?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, the slide is related to a characteristic of digital IC. So I hope it is visible to all of you.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So welcome to the video lecture on characteristic of digital IC. I am ST Kumbhare, lecturer electronics engineering at Government Polytechnic Gondia. So the topic for today's presentation are we'll have a basic introduction, then we'll see Moore's law. It is not in your curriculum, but still it is a very famous law and that should be known to the person who is going to study this digital technique. So that's why I'm going to tell you this also. It is not in your curriculum, but still you have to know this. Then, and it is not that difficult also. So we'll see cover this also. Then we'll see the some of the characteristic of digital ICs which are there in your curriculum. And at the end, we will see the classification of logic family. So basically this topic is, whatever this lecture we are conducting today, it is a part of digital logic families. So we are having a prior knowledge of that, and then we'll see the actual digital family in digital logic family in next lecture or upcoming lecture. So the outcome of today's presentation are, you will be able to tell the Moore's law. Then you will be able to identify different level of integration in digital ICs. Then you will be able to list down and describe different characteristic of digital ICs. And at the end, you will be able to classify logic families depending on level of integration. So in order to understand logic family, you should be aware about level of integration, and that we'll see today. So basic introduction are, logic gates are available in the form of integrated circuits, which we normally known as ICs. Then as per the level of integration, the ICs can accommodate more number of logic gates and digital functions. So when you will see this, level of integration, you will come to know that how it is and how we can accommodate more number of logic gates and digital functions. And then this forms basically referred as logic family. This is just a brief. Then what is level of integration? So you can see on your screen a different level of integrations are shown. It is basically in a single IC, how many gates we can accommodate. That is called as level of integration. In the initial stage, when we were in the development stage, and the technology was not evolved much, at that point, the ICs were designed with lower number of gates, like lesser than 10 or 12 gates. And that sort of integration is known as small scale integration. So if you are having a IC which has less number of gates, lesser than 12, then that is designed or manufactured with the help of small scale integration, which is famously known as SSI technology or SSI integration. Next one is medium scale integration. On the screen you can observe medium scale integration, which is famously known as MSI technology or MSI integration, which has basically less than 100 gates per chip, means in IC, that is integrated chip or circuit, you are going to have less than 100 gates, then that can be manufactured with the help of MSI or medium scale integration technology. Next is large scale integration, LSI, which has less than 1K gates. After that, VLSI came in picture, very large scale integration, VLSI, which has less than 10K gates. Nowadays, also we call VLSI, but this is evolved VLSI or advanced VLSI, we can say, which has greater than 10^8 gates per chip. Now, if you observe, in previous days also, we were having the size of chip, and that size nowadays also can be observed. But if you find the functionality of previous IC and today's IC is having a vast difference, and that too because the technology using which it was manufactured. Previously, it was manufactured with either SSI or MSI, but nowadays it is manufactured with VLSI, advanced VLSI. And if that is, then there will be more number of gates, and if more number of gates are accommodated, obviously you will find lots of functionalities available on the single IC. And in this, basically nanometer technology came in picture. Nanometer technology means the size of a single gate. Means in previously, if we were using small scale integration, then it may happen that we were using millimeter technology, means a single gate is of size in some millimeters. But nowadays, if you observe the motherboard processors, you will find that the ICs processor ICs are having the components or gates of size 10 or 12 or 14 nanometer size. So if you are having a smaller size of gate, then obviously you can accommodate more number of gates in a same area. So that is the basic thing about level of integration. So that's why we are right now in the era of VLSI, and which has lots of gates in a single IC. So this thing you have to just remember, that small scale integration has less than 12 gates, medium scale integration has less than 100 gates, large scale integration has less than 1K gates or 1000 gates, then very large scale integration has less than 10K gates or 10,000 gates, and nowadays VLSI is using greater than 10^8 gates. Okay. Now Moore's law. Basically, in 1965, the co-founder of Intel, Gordon Moore, predicted a basic assumption, or he has given some prediction, and that is applicable right now also from 1965. Means how much further he has seen? It's almost, I think, 60 years, not 60 or 55 years has gone or passed, but since still it is applicable. What he said, that number of transistors per square inch to double every year since their invention. Means from the starting of invention, every year you will find a increase in the number of transistors in a square inch. Square inch means inch square, or the area of square inch. You will, in every year, you will find that the number of transistors or gates will double. Okay. And that is applicable right now. If you see the statistics, you will find that it is in every 18 months, that is 1.5 years, this number of transistors are getting doubled per square inch. So if you observe this picture, you will find that in 1971, we were having a process microprocessor 4004. Then 1972 we were having 8008, and these processors are evolving like this. Now this this picture is a bit older. Right now we are having i3, i5, then i7 processors. In that also we were having different versions like Ice Lake and all. Okay, you can check on net. So there you will find that the number of gates or transistors are increasing in a exponential manner. That too because every year, because of evolution of technology, number of transistors which we can accommodate in a square inch is doubling. Okay, means if in 4004 if we were having 10 transistors, in 8008 we were having 20 transistors, in 8080 we will having 40 transistors, in 8086 80, 286 you can say 160. Just a broader way I'm giving you, not exactly 386, more double than that. So like this, every time number of transistors will double, and because of that you will observe that nowadays processors are much more faster, as well as they are having lot of functionality. Now what is the benefit of having lots of functionality on a single chip? The benefit is that if you are having most of the functionality in a single chip, there is no need to connect additional components outside of that IC. And if you are not going to connect additional components outside of that IC, obviously the space of overall product will reduce, as well as the cost will also reduce. Overall cost, okay, not the IC cost, overall cost will reduce. So that is the benefit. So this is Moore's law. What Moore's law is saying, that number of transistors per square inch will double every year since their invention. This is Moore's law. Means every year the number of transistors will double per square inch. Okay, next, characteristic of digital analysis. So in your curriculum it is said this six characteristic: propagation delay, noise margin, power dissipation, threshold logic levels, then fan in, fan out. Okay, six characteristics are mentioned in this, in your curriculum. But give me a minute, madam, lecture with them. So in your curriculum, they have mentioned six characteristic. But apart from this, there are few more characteristic like current and voltage parameter, operating temperature range, power supply requirement, and flexibilities available. So like this, we were having different characteristics. Now what are these? We'll see one by one. First of all, we'll see propagation delay. So propagation delay is basically average transition delay time for the signal to propagate from input to output. So this is basic definition. Now what does it mean? You can see in picture. This is basic NAND gate, where we are applying one input and second input is connected to VCC. Okay, this is basically a VCC. Okay, this is your let me change the ink, it's not visible. Okay, so this is your VCC. This is your VCC. So one terminal is connected to VCC, then the input is connected to second terminal. This is ground. This, okay, this one is ground. Now when you apply input, because of this NAND gate, the truth table of NAND gate is, if you are having input as A, then another input as B, then the output Y. So the if the input is 0 0, you will get output as 1. If the input is 0 1, you will get output as 1. If the input is 10, you will get output as 1, and if the input is 11, the output will be 0. This is basic truth table of NAND gate. And so one input is connected to VCC means we cannot consider this. So this is not applicable because both the inputs are 0, 0. Then this also will not consider. So we are going to consider this and this because this B input I'm considering that it is connected to VCC. So this one and this one. Now this A is nothing but your VI. This VI can be either 0 or can be 1. So if input is 0, output will be 1. And if input is 1, output will be 0. Okay, I think all of you got this. So if I'm applying VI as 0 over here, then I'm getting the output as 1. Look here, VI is applied as 0 and you are getting output as 1. As soon as I change input from low to high, okay, low to high means input will change to 0 to 1. The output should also change from 1 to 0. This change should happen. Okay, one more thing I would like to tell you that even most of the time we see that if we are changing input from 0 to 1, we expect that it should be sudden change like this. Okay, like this. We are expecting change like this, but keep in mind that in signals or in electronics, what happened? We cannot get such type of high spike, sudden spike. We cannot get. Reason is basically signals are generated with the help of voltage and current, and if those are generated with the help of voltage and current. For changing the voltage level from low to high, you need some time, either in nanosecond or microsecond, but some time you need. Okay, so this time can be your nanosecond, in nanosecond. So there will be change like this every time. Okay, from low to high and from high to low like this. Sudden change you will never observe. Even though you will observe, if you it is not like that. So if I'm changing input from low to high, since gate is there, NAND gate is there, there will be some transistor inside this. So in order to operate that, they will take some time. Now, so whenever I apply input, change in input, and I'm getting output, change in output after some time. So the difference between this point to this point is known as propagation delay. Okay, means 50% of input change to 50% of output change. This whatever time delay is required, that is called as propagation delay. Time difference is known as delay. But since this is happening because of propagation, means input is propagating to the output. Propagation is nothing but traveling. Okay, propagation is nothing but traveling, means signal is traveling from input to output, and that propagation or traveling whatever delay is coming in picture, that is called as propagation delay. So this is called as propagation delay, high to low. TPD, HL means time is time, propagation delay. Okay, so time required for propagation delay when high to low means whenever there is a change from high to low side. Similarly, we will see that if the input is changing from higher side to lower side, you have to take 50% of the signal strength from here, okay, to the point when the output is changing from lower side to higher side, 50% of that. So the time required between this is called as propagation delay from lower to high. Now this and this can be equal or minor difference is there, but we can consider both similar. So I hope this is clear to you, all of you. Is it clear? Please reply. Anyone? Please unmute yourself and reply.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So propagation delay is nothing but time required for change in output after change in input. Means the time required for change in output, this output after change in input is called as propagation delay. So speed power product is given as propagation delay into P average, that is average power required. Next factor is noise margin. So what is noise margin? The quantitative measure of noise immunity is called noise margin. Okay, and what is noise immunity then? Noise immunity is the maximum noise that a circuit can withstand without affecting the output. Okay, so I think all of you get this. So what basically I want to mean, noise immunity is the maximum noise that a circuit can withstand without affecting the output. Just let's give me an example. Let's take an example that our class is going on and there is a noise outside my class. I can teach you till the point that noise is less, but as soon as that noise got bigger and whatever I'm speaking, if you are not able to hear that, it means that my noise margin is not, or noise immunity is over. So basically whatever noise or outside unwanted signal, okay, unwanted signal is getting control over my actual signal, then my noise margin will be over. So for example, if, okay, so I think all of you got this. So basically noise margin is maximum noise or maximum unwanted signal that a circuit can withstand, means it can handle without affecting the output. If you are not, because of noise, if your output is getting affected, it means that noise is very high and your noise immunity is low. Okay, so the quantitative measure of this noise immunity is called as noise margin. Okay, what it means? In digital ICs, we normally have logic 1 and logic 0. Logic 1 is also represented as high or 1, and logic 0 is represented as 0 or low. Okay, so even though I'm saying logic 1 is nothing but equal to 5 volt or plus or 5, okay, and logic 0 is referred to as 0 volt, as I have previously told you that even though we are saying logic 0 means 0, it is never like that, because you have to identify whether it is a breakage in line or whether it is a actual low signal. What we normally do, we do not send 0 for logic 0. We normally send some millivolt or some milliampere current for logic 0. Now, if we, even though I am saying that, it doesn't mean that if I am getting 5 volt, then only I will say that it is 1. What we used to do, we used to keep some margin. Okay, means if even though I'm saying 5, it can be accepted that from let us say 3 volt to 5 volt I can consider it as logic 1. Why it is so? Because of noise, suppose I'm getting a signal like this. Wait. Suppose I am having a signal like this. Okay, this is 5 volt and this is 0 volt. Let just assume. And because of noise, this signal may get fluctuate like this. So what happens now? This signal is not of 5 volt. You will observe that it is greater than 5 volt and it is lower than 5 volt. Then if you are sticking to 5 volt as one logic 1, then it will not work. Then what you have to do, you have to consider some buffer between this, means 5 volt to something. So I can consider that, okay, till 3 volt, if the signal falling because of noise, I can assume it as 1. So, and above 5, I will consider it as 1. Similarly, for 0, I can say that, okay, till 1.5, the signal I will consider it as low, and if the signal goes above 1.5, I'll not treat it as low. So 1.5 volt to zero, I'll treat it as low volt. So this is called as basically noise match, that you are providing a change in signal because of noise. So theoretically, what it means, let's see. High state noise margin VNH is equals to, okay, noise margin high state is equals to VOH output voltage high side minimum minus VIH input voltage high side minimum. And similarly, low state noise margin on lower side, VIL max, okay, VIL max, that is input low voltage maximum minus VOL max output low voltage maximum, it will give you VNL, and minimum of these two, it will give you the noise margin. Now how you will identify that, you can see the picture. Here in picture, this is your this is input side, this is output side. So this is your VIH, because this is high side, so VIH minimum, okay, this is VIH minimum, this is VIH maximum, okay, and this is VIL maximum, and this is VIL minimum. Similarly, here this is your VOH minimum, this is VOH maximum, this is VIH maximum, this is VIH minimum. So if you find this, what I said, this is VOH what minimum, because for this high side, this is minimum level and this is maximum level, and this is VO for lower side, this is max. Okay, similarly, this is VIL max and this is VIH min. Now you can subtract this, so VNH will give you VOH minimum minus VIH minimum, and this is VNL will give you VIL max minus VOL max, and the minimum between these two is will give you the noise margin. So I hope this is clear to all of you. Just you have to remember the definitions. Other things is for understanding purpose and describing purpose. Let's go to the next slide. Power dissipation. It is also known as static power dissipation. It is the amount of power dissipated in an IC. Okay. So if you are having an IC and if you have applied power supply, then whatever power is going to be dissipated or dropped in the IC is known as power dissipation. Okay. Normally it is DC power dissipation. Why DC power dissipation? Because our ICs normally work on DC power supply. So this is also known as DC power dissipation, and its unit is in milliwatts. Okay. And it is given by VCC into ICC. VCC is your power supply, which you are going to apply. And ICC is the average DC current, which is fetched from this power supply, VCC. Okay. So this is what we can say, power dissipation. Now this power dissipation should be less. Why? Because we have already studied the law of conservation of energy. What it says, that energy can neither be created nor be destroyed, but it can be converted in from one form to another form. So if you are having electricity as a energy, and if it is going to dissipate or drop in your IC, that will not be destroyed. Then it will be converted into another form, which is normally in the form of heat. And if heat is getting higher, what will happen? your IC will be more hotter. And if your IC gets heated up, then your IC may get damaged. That's why if you observe, normally in server rooms, we place ACs, air conditioning. Why? Because your servers are working continuously 24/7. And if they are working continuously for a longer duration, obviously more power will be consumed by your servers. And if more power is getting consumed, the more heat will be generated in that. And in order to reduce the temperature of processors, we have to provide cooling effect. And that cooling effect is provided with the help of ACs. So that's why it is expected that power dissipation of the IC should be very less. Okay, and that can be done with different ways, which is not out of your scope, out of this syllabus. So I'll not discuss that. But just keep in mind that this parameter is of much more importance. So if you are choosing any IC, you should see what is the power dissipation of that IC. If that IC is having very high power dissipation, it means that you need to provide cooling. And how that cooling can be provided? Either with the help of airflow, you can put a fan, which normally we use in our computers or PCs. We have a fan. I think all of you can remember. So what is the use of that fan in laptops or computers? Basically, that is taking out the heat from the processor in the outside world, so that your processor will be less heated and it will work for more time. That is the basic aim. So this is one of the important. Then threshold logic level, the level at which circuit changes from one state to another state. So if your circuit changing output from one state to another state, there will be some level, and that is called as threshold logic level. Next, fan-in. Fan-in is also one of the important parameter. So basically it means that number of inputs that the gate can handle properly without disturbing output level. So suppose this is my gate AND gate, if I am having number of inputs, then this device has a capacity that how much inputs it can handle. Just take an example that in our home, if we are having a small children, single children, then we can handle it very well if single person is there. But if you have two children at home and if a single person is there, then it is a bit difficult, but still you can manage to handle those two childs. But if you have more than two children, like eight children or like that in your home, and only one single parent is at home, what will happen? That person will not be able to handle those many inputs. So because its fan-in capacity is less. So this is nothing but fan-in. How many number of inputs a gate can handle? That is called as fan-in. And the inverse of this is known as fan-out. How many outputs you can handle? That is called as fan-out, because you are going to output. So number of similar gates which can be driven by a gate is known as fan out, and high fan out is advantageous, because if with the help of single gate I am able to handle more number of devices, then there is no need of putting an additional component in the circuitry, and that will reduce the cost as well as that will reduce the space requirement for the device. So that is called as fan out. So we have almost covered all the parameters which is mentioned in your curriculum. I hope all of you got this. Now depending on integration level of integration, that is SSI, MSI, LSI, VLSI, the logic families can be classified like this. So basically there are two major classification, like unipolar and bipolar. Unipolar and bipolar means unipolar means single polarity, means you will either have 0 volt or 5 volt. In bipolar you can have two polarities. either plus 5 volt or minus 5 volt. So on positive and negative, you will get the outputs. Then that is called as bipolar. Unipolar, you are going to get only single sound output. For example,
Sir, invisible नहीं है. Yes, sir.
From what time it is not visible? (11:39) 2 minutes. Okay, if such type of problem occurs, please unmute yourself and let me know, because I'm not able to see your chats because I'm teaching, so it's a bit difficult to see your chats and have concentration on that. Okay, so just unmute yourself and let me know. Okay, is the screen visible now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay, fine. So digital, okay, fan in and fan out, all of you got?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so
Yes, sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, can you repeat once again?
Okay, fan in is nothing but number of inputs that a gate can handle properly without disturbing the output. Means if I'm having a gate, and how many inputs it can handle at a time, that is called as fan in. And the inverse of that is how many different outputs you can control with a single gate, that is called as fan out. Okay, so if I am having a higher fan out, it means that I can handle more number of devices with the help of single gate or single IC. And if I okay, and that has benefit that if I am able to handle more number of components on the output side, there is no need of additional circuitry. And if there is no need of additional circuitry, obviously the space required as well as cost of that device will be less. So that's why it is expected that fan out should be very high. Then logic family. Logic family classification. So such type of classification can be done for logic families with the help of level of integration. We normally do this. Then it has basic classification as unipolar and bipolar. The difference between this is, suppose I am having this is 0 volt. If the output is going on only one side, then this is called as unipolar. For example, if I am having output like this, means 0 volt and 5 volt only or 12 volt only on one side only, okay, one side only, then this is called as unipolar device. Okay, and whereas bipolar is nothing but your output will go on both side, that is you will have either 5 volt or you can have minus 5. So like this you can have two levels, that is called as bipolar. Then in unipolar we have three types: PMOS, NMOS, and CMOS. PMOS is nothing but P-type MOSFET. NMOS is nothing but N-type MOSFET. And CMOS is nothing but complementary MOSFET. Now, what is meant by complementary MOSFET? In complementary MOSFET, we have both the MOSFETs, P and NMOS. Okay, we'll see this in detail. So, CMOS consists of both PMOS as well as NMOS. So in a single CMOS, we have both PMOS and NMOS. Then this is called as CMOS. Then in bipolar, we have two different types, saturated and non-saturated. Saturated means your output will saturate at one level. For example, like this. Okay, it will saturate at this 5 volt. Then this is called as saturated. And non-saturated means it will not saturate at one level, it will be at it will be adding. Okay, then this is called as, or 5 volts, sometimes I will get 5 volts, sometimes I will get 12 volts, so it will not saturate basically. Then this is called as non-saturated. So again, saturated are divided into this classification: RTL, DCTL, IIL, DTL, high threshold transistor logic, TTL. And non-saturated is classified into Schottky TTL and ECL. We'll see some of these which are there in your curriculum one by one, and then we'll discuss that and at the end we have to compare those. So that is the end of today's presentation. These are the references. So you can use that for understand. If you have any difficulty, you can ask me right now on this current presentation. Anyone is having any difficulty?
No, sir.
Okay, no difficulty.
No, sir.
What about others? Do you have any difficulty?
No, sir.
Okay, fine. So I hope today's topic is clear to all of you.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
Yes, sir.
So okay. So wait, give me a minute. Fine. Now if you have any difficulty in previous presentations, I will open one by one PPT, and if you have any difficulty, just let me know. I'll discuss those. Okay, one by one. Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so the first topic we covered was DTM introduction. So I think give me a minute. I will share that screen also. Okay, I will. Is this presentation visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, in this, if you have any doubt, let me know. I will clear it.
No doubt, sir.
No doubt. What about the doubts?
Yes, sir. No doubt.
No, sir.
Okay, fine. These are theoretical things, so no doubt. From practical point of view, I would like to tell you something. We are going to start our practical from the next week. Okay. So you have to do at home itself. So I have already shared the lab manual. I will paste it in the Google Classroom also. So starting from first practical, you have to do the practical. Now how to do the practical, that I will tell you. You have to use one software I have, Tinkercad. I have already told you, right?
Yes, sir.
So that the videos related to that, I will post on the Google Classroom. All of you try to do it. You have to perform the practicals using Tinkercad. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So we'll start the practicals from next week, so that we will not delay whatever we are going through. Then micro project. Related to micro project, I would like to tell you that all of you please form a group right now, starting from now. Group of 3 students, okay, not more than 3.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir.
Roll number wise,
not needed. You take your own friends. It is your choice. I'm not forcing anything on you. Just one thing is, the group should be of maximum 3 students, not more than that.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
So talk with your friends, make a group of 3 students, and as soon as you form a group of 3 students, post that in Google Classroom. Okay, that sir, this is our group and we are going to prepare a micro project on this topic. So that topic also you mention in that. Okay.
Yes, sir.
All of you have to make a group of 3 students, discuss with each other, then if you have formed the group, just do one thing, post that in the Google Classroom that, sir, we have made this group and this is our topic of micro project. Fine. So along with group, you have to give the micro project title name also.
Yes, sir.
So do it fast, because again, one thing I would like to, if one of the group has selected one micro project and if other group is also planning for that, but I will allow only one micro project throughout the class. Means, for example, if anyone is selecting burglar alarm over here, and if another group is also wanted to do this, but the first group has already posted that, sir, I'm going to create burglar alarm, then I will treat his project as the registered one. I will not consider the others, who means first come first serve. It is similar to that. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So those students who placed initially, I will allow them.
Okay, yes.
Okay, next, the books you have to refer is RPGen for digital electronics, and microprocessor Burchendi. So I have this RPGen book PDF available with me that I will also post on the Google Classroom. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Next. Next slide was introduction to number system. I'll present that presentation. Okay, is this slide visible? Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yes, fine. Sir.
Is any doubt in this?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No, sir.
Okay. All of you, please have a concentration on the screen. And if you are having any doubts, let me know.
Okay, sir.
Next. Yes, sir. Decimal number system.
No, sir.
No, sir.
Okay. Binary number system?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Yesterday, someone was asking, some girl was asking related to her problem. Where is she now? Is she present today?
Yes, sir.
Any doubt in this?
No, sir.
Okay, any doubt in this?
No, sir.
Any doubt in this?
No, sir.
Okay, give me a minute. Hello, sir. Awesome. हाँ कॉलेज को तीन लेटर हो गए, एक लेटर नहीं आर को देने वाले तो प्रॉब्लम चला गया. अच्छा. अच्छा. Okay, sorry for the distance. This is clear. Okay, is any difficulty in this?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Okay, hexadecimal.
No, sir.
Anyone is having any difficulty in this, please? Okay, then
no, sir.
Conversion?
No, sir.
Sir,
any difficulty?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Okay, fine. So I'll go to the next slide. No issue in this. Hello.
No, sir.
Next. Any issue in any of the PPTs? Just let me know so that I will open that PPT only. Any of you is having any difficulty?
No, sir.
Yesterday someone was asking, that's why I am asking. Kamlesh Naikin, any difficulty in previous topics which we covered?
No, sir.
Ruchita Thakre?
No, sir, no difficulty.
Achi Lillare?
Yes, sir.
Any difficulty? Let me know.
Octal to binary conversion में problem जाती है.
Octal to? Okay, I will open that PPT. Give me a minute. Conversion of number system. Okay, I'll present that. Present now. Present the window. Conversion. Sure. Okay, decimal to binary is clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, decimal to octal?
Yes, sir.
Okay, then decimal to hexadecimal?
Yes, sir.
Binary to octal?
No, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, octal to binary?
No, sir.
And no, miss, if you are having any difficulty, let me know. Huh?
The difficulty hai binary to octal to binary mein.
Okay. In octal to binary, if you are having a difficulty, just okay, fine. What you will do, suppose a octal number like this 6 to 4 is given, and you want to convert it into binary. What you will do? You have to represent this. Means you have to segregate these digits like this 6, 2, and 4 separately, and then you have to represent this 6 in its 3-bit binary form. Whenever I say octal to binary, it is 3-bit. Whenever I say octal to hexadecimal, it is 4-bit conversion. Okay, so since I want octal to binary, I will convert this 6 into 3-bit binary equivalent, and that is 110. 2 is 010, and 4 is 100. After this, I have to club all these bits like this. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
Any doubt in this?
No, sir.
Okay, suppose same thing, 6, 2, 4 in hexadecimal. If I want to convert this into binary, what to do? Again, I will segregate 6, 2, and 4. And since I want hexadecimal to binary, I will convert these digits into 4-bit equivalent binary. So this becomes 0, 1, 1, 0. This 2 becomes 0, 0, 1, 0. And 4 becomes 0, 1, 0, 0. So this becomes this hexadecimal to binary. And this is octal to binary. So both are similar. Only difference is in octal you have to consider 3-bit. In hexadecimal you have to consider 4-bit.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Any other doubt?
No, sir.
What about others?
No doubt, sir.
Okay, Kamlesh Nagin, any doubt? Any other doubts by anyone?
No, sir.
Okay,
no,
fine.
Sir.
Okay, fine. Then we'll stop over here. I will upload today's attendance also and today's recording also for your reference purpose. Okay.
Hello.
Ashwin, tell me.
सर वो जो स्टार्टिंग के 3 लेक्चर बीसीडी कोर्स का कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं सर, उसके बाद जो लेक्चर है उसकी तो पीपीटी भी नहीं मिले सर.
I will share those PPTs also. Basically, what I am expecting that as soon as I will get the time, I will record those session also and simultaneously I will upload PPT as well as recording. But okay, fine. I'll do one thing. I will upload the PPT today itself. Then, as soon as the recording will be over, I will upload the recording also. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Any other doubts?
Sir.
Tell me.
और इंटीजर एक ही नंबर में रहा डेसिमल में और हमें बाइनरी में कन्वर्ट करना है तो
डेसिमल में है एंड बाइनरी में कन्वर्ट करना है राइट.
हाँ सर, इंटीजर और फ्रैक्शन मतलब पॉइंट में क्वेश्चन रहा तो.
ओके, वेट आई विल शो यू द दैट थिंग आल्सो एंड लेट मी नो इफ यू आर आस्किंग फॉर दिस और व्हाट. Are you asking for this?
Yes, sir.
Wait. Okay, are you asking for this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, what you will do, you have to segregate integer part and fractional part like this. Here I have segregated integer and this is fractional. Integer part we can convert into binary like this, which we have already covered. For a fractional, what you will do, you have to multiply this 0.625 into 2. Okay, because I want to convert this decimal into binary, that's why I'm multiplying with 2. Suppose I want to convert into octal, I will multiply it with 8. And if I want to convert it into hexadecimal, I will multiply it with 16. So you have to use the base, basically. After multiplying this, whatever full digit you are getting, here full digit is 1, so that you will take out. And the fractional part, again, you will multiply it with 2. Again, what if you are now here, we are not getting any fractional integer part. So 0 will be taken as it is. And this 0.500 will be multiplied with 2 again. And then as soon as you get 0.000, just you have to stop. Now here 101. So the binary equivalent of 0.625 is 0.101. And now this you have to club this one as well as this one. So 1010.101. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Any doubt?
No, sir.
एनी अदर डाउट्स?
नो सर।
पीपीटी वीडियो रिकॉर्डिंग कब तक मिल जाएंगे?
I will upload the PPT by today itself, all the PPTs. Okay, which I have not already uploaded, that I will upload. Recording which already recorded, I have already uploaded, I guess, most of those. Some are missing because those recording got missed due to light and some other issues. So that I will record as soon as I will get some time, because that needs time. Okay. Any other doubt? Fine, then we will conclude this session now. You can leave the session. Thank you all.